measure of wealth. Need a measure. You can have $20,000 US dollars this month and buy you maybe a car. But you never know. Next month, that $20,000 may not buy you a car because the value has dropped. Money is only as valuable as what we assign it to be to have. One of the things about the church is we teach people how to save quite a lot. But we don't really teach people how to spend. And money is only as valuable as when it is spent. If you don't spend your money, actually, it really has only potential value. It has no real value. So you have to spend the money for it to become valuable. You put it in a pillowcase, you know. It has potential value, but you know, it's not real value. Just think about it. And we shouldn't be embarrassed in the church to talk about money. They estimated that Jesus talk about money more than he talked about heaven and hell together. Yeah, you count the number of verses where Jesus referred to money, you count the number of verses where Jesus referred to heaven and hell, there are more verses where Jesus referred to money than when Jesus referred to heaven and hell. So money is quite a big issue, evidently, even during the time of Jesus. We should talk about giving, we should talk about money in the church, but we should talk about it on a regular, what I'm saying is not all the time, but on a regular basis, so that people, it is a part of the full counsel of God. The problem sometimes with church is, we only talk about money when we need it. And then people begin to suspect our motivation. Oh, now they need money already, come again. But if it is something regular, it is something that is a part of your teaching, then it's not a problem. It's the full counsel of God. In fact, if you don't teach about giving, as pastors, if you don't teach about giving, you are depriving your members of the full blessings of God. Because it's more blessed to give than to receive. It is a part of the Christian responsibility, the Christian of life, Christian life and everything. It's more blessed to give than to receive. Now let me explain this God, people, land thing. I already gave you the very brief background. How in the Old Testament, God, people and land are the elements of nationhood. And why they are so important to people of Israel. The first five books of the Bible talks about God, talks about people, talks about land. These are the major themes of the first five books of the Bible. God, people, and land. And today, as we translate this and apply this into modern life, we can see some similarity. I would not say it, some parallelism. And I would not expect all of you to tell the technical people. Sorry, thank you. Thank you. Once again, some question I didn't even know. The brother at the back just asked me a question after the session. So if you have any questions, if not, afterwards I ask some questions and you get the right answer, I'll give you a word. But our school in Baguio welcomes anyone of you. In fact, I've told some teachers you can perhaps consider having your church camp at Baguio in our school. After all, Air Asia says everyone can fly. So you can fly there and have a week there. One church was very creative. You know, when you have a retreat, you want to employ an international speaker, a foreign speaker, and you have to pay for everything. So instead of that, they fly everyone to Philippines, and then he combined the church camp with another local Filipino church camp. So the two are good friends. So they have a combined church camp with a Filipino church. And the two pastors were the speakers. So the Filipino church get an international speaker, the Malaysian church get an international speaker also. In fact, they even had a camp in two cities. They landed in Manila first, and they stayed there for one night. They had services there, they toured the place there, and then they drove up, they got bus them up to Baguio. Then they stayed another two nights in Baguio. So along the way, they visited quite a lot of places. Because of the rain, a sudden rain, huh? Okay. Thanks. Now, the three areas of real wealth is God, people, and land. God is quite often. God is like our capital. God is our true source of wealth and our true wealth itself. Number one. In fact, if you are doing, and the people is also, Jesus came to die for people. People of value, much more value than we actually assign to people. And then land. Actually, all the material wealth that you can think about is trapped in this earth. Not the material wealth, it's from the earth. If you're an investor, you will, if you're buying stocks or what, one of the things that you have been taught to look at is to look at the land holdings of the company. The more land the company has, the more stable the company is. Because land is wealth. In fact, all the wealth that you can generate on this earth comes from land. In the Old Testament, land and wealth, land and earth are the same words. Come from the earth. And the nearer to earth, your investment, the more earth-based it is, the more land-based it is, usually the safer it is. Usually. Now, I'm not teaching investment. I'm just sharing you with some observations. The more earth-based your investment is, the safer and it is. The more it goes away from the earth, the riskier it is. So if you're into agricultural, primary industries, usually it's safer, the investment. But if you're into production, manufacturing, it's a little bit further away. But if you're into information and all these things, it's even further away. It becomes a little riskier as we go along. If you have a high technology, it's even further away. The further away from Earth, the less Earth-based it is, the riskier it becomes. Because real wealth is in the Earth. for me to use. Because blessings really they're very earth-based. If your Old Testament understanding of wealth is to do with the earth, to do with the land. Today, let's be, you know, for this, you inherit a lot of money. I mean, if we talk about it today, maybe we inherit a lot of money. But at that time, we inherit the earth. This is much more stable than money, much more stable than anything. Again, like I say, I'm not talking about economics or what, I'm just talking about some principles here. God created the earth for us to live in, to survive, and that is true wealth is given to us. It's quite interesting because wealth cannot be generated outside of this earth. Cannot be. All the wealth that we can ever have, material wealth, is in this earth. It's here. All the material wealth. So the more earth-based your investment is, the safer it is. If that verse were to be written today by some people, it would be, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit a lot of money. But in the Old Testament biblical understanding, earth is more important even than money. Because earth is real wealth. Now, this tree, of course, if you want to do to prioritize them, God is number one, without doubt. And then people is number two, land is number three. If you want to prioritize it. Now, for unbelievers, it is opposite. For unbelievers, land, material wealth is the most important. They want to gather as much as they can. And then when they have some extra left behind, maybe they will offer scholarship. They invest in people. They give scholarship to this school, help this school, but it's left over. And after they've done that, they still have some left over, maybe they give a bit to God. Maybe some religious thing. But for the Christian, it's the other way around. You give to God first. You invest in God first. And then you invest in people, and then you invest in them. That's the Christian way of prioritizing. I'm just talking about resources here. You have three resources in Christian: God, people, and them. What are you going to invest in first? God first. People number two. Land number three. When I say land, I mean earth-based wealth. Earth-based wealth. Not wealth that you can take away with you to heaven, but earth-based wealth. So think about it, just think about it. I'm not sure I can elaborate too much, but thank you, Salil, for that. I think your verse is very helpful. I'll be using it the next time. So let me give you a tick-o. Yes. Thank you. Hopefully, I'm sure that I stroke. I'll finish the fourth module. The fourth module will talk about that. Thank you very much. Our mission is more than just evangelism on earth. But these three, the next slide that I want to show you, I think will be very helpful for you. We use the word blessing all the time. We say, bless somebody, bless you, I bless you, you bless me, and God bless you. We use the word blessing all the time. And it is a very popular word in the Bible. It's all through the Bible. Almost every book of the Bible has the word bless, or blessing, or blessedness, or blessing. You know, that word is found everywhere. Blessing. The Chinese has that word also. The Chinese of hope. They all want the blessing to come back to them. That's why they take the word blessing, turn it upside down in the house so that it will come back to them. Blessing. But what is blessing? What really is blessing? When they say, I bless you, what does it mean? You give? You know, it's very interesting. When Jesus was going up to heaven, it says that he raised his hands and bless the disciples. What does he mean? When he raised his hand to bless the disciples. I won't be able to touch on everything, but I want to start you off on some foundational things so that you can do your own research and whatnot. Just a foundational understanding of blessing. Just very basic. The first three times the word blessing is found in the Bible, it's found in Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2. In the Bible, in interpreting the Bible, there's a certain principle called the principle of first mention. That means the first time that word is mentioned in the Bible is the most foundational and basic meaning is there. And I'm going to use that principle. The first time the word is mentioned is found in Genesis chapter 1 verse 22. Genesis 1, 20, is it 22, 28, let me see. 22, yeah. Genesis chapter 1 verse 22. Genesis chapter 1 verse 22. Can someone read? Can someone shout the verse out? So be fruitful and multiply, fill. So the most basic understanding of the word blessing is abundance. Multiply, fill a lot. That's the most basic. Even non-Christians know that. When you're blessed, you have a lot of money. When you're blessed, you become very fat or whatever. You have a lot. You have a lot. Once you're blessed, you have a lot. You have abundance. You fill, multiply. That's blessing. That's the most basic, most fundamental understanding of the word blessing. So, it is wrong to say to someone, God bless you, when you're poor. Because that is not a fundamental understanding of the word blessing. Blessing doesn't take away. Blessing fill, blessing multiply. To say that God bless you and when you're poor, it's just... it's not the definition of the word. The most fundamental, basic meaning of the word is abundance. If you're blessed, you will have abundance. That's most basic. Of course, that's basic. If you just use that word in its most basic meaning, perhaps you will end up with prosperity gospel. Because that's all you know. That's most basic understanding. It's not wrong, but it's not full truth yet. So when you say to somebody that God bless you and make you poor, maybe some of you are thinking, hey, sometimes it happens, you know, because when a person becomes poor, then he becomes humble. When he becomes humble, he becomes more spiritual. Then God bless him. Sometimes we use the word blessing in disguise. But we must not confuse the blessing with the disguise. The disguise is not the blessing. So the poverty is not the blessing. What comes after that could be a blessing. But the poverty in and of itself is not a blessing. But this is the basic understanding. We need to move on to the next level. And the next time this verse appears in Genesis 1:28, it says, somebody read that verse 1:28. So the second time God blessed, God said the same thing. Be fruitful, multiply. But then God added a new element to it and said, subdue the earth, rule over the earth, have influence over the earth, take care of the earth. The earth is under your control now. You are responsible for it now. So the second idea of blessing is authority. When you are blessed, you have authority. When you are blessed, you have influence. When you are blessed, you will make some changes in the environment, in other people's lives. That is blessing. Not just abundance, but authority as well to touch other people's lives. When you are blessed, your life, not only your life is affected, but other people's lives are affected too. That is a higher level of understanding blessing. Some people stop, unfortunately, at the lowest level and never go on to the second level of understanding blessing. Third one is in Genesis chapter 2, verse 3. Genesis chapter 2, verse 3. God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. This is third time, first three times, and the third of the first three times the word blessed or blessing, blessed is used in the Bible. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Holiness means to be set apart. Holiness means it is good enough for God to use. It is set apart, is approved by God. God can use it. You know, it's different from other days. That day is special. That day has been marked and stamped with a special quality. That is blessing. When God marks you out as a special person, that's blessing. My sons all attended the same Chinese school. When they were primary school, Chinese school, dressed same uniform, everything, you know, no long hair required, allowed in those days, all short hair, you know, and when the school bell ring, all these children run out, you know, sometimes I send one of my church members, as a taxi driver, to go and pick up my son. When I was mastering, I had no time, and he went, he difficult for him to find my son. You know, 2,000 kids all running out, you know. Then the school bell ring, all wearing the same uniform, all about the same. You can't find my son. But if we were to go, we can easily spot our sons from among the crowd. Because those are our sons. We have marked them up, they're special to us. You know, you are like them. God has marked you up, you are special to Him. And that's a blessing. That's a blessing. You know how God loves you. You know how God loves you. God reminded me of this. You know, God loves me. Not because of anything I have done. You know, when the heavens opened at Jesus' baptism and the voice declared, the Father declared, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." At that time, Jesus has done nothing yet. He has not preached any sermon yet. He has not done any miracles yet. He has not done anything yet. He has not started his ministry yet. He has not achieved anything yet. He has not started his mission yet. And yet the Father says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." God loves us not because of anything we have done. You know when I love my son the most? When I first saw him in the hospital. Oh, I loved him so much at that time. But he has not done anything yet. Hasn't even opened his eyes yet. Doesn't even know how to call me Papa yet. And yet I love him. You see, it has nothing to do with what he can do for me, what he can achieve. He's my son. God loves you. Proved you, you are special to Him, you are His child. God loves you. And that's the highest idea of blessing. God has set you up. So blessing is not just abundance, not just authority, but approval as well. So when you are approved, maybe we can superimpose what we have learned earlier about God, land, our people, you know, with approval from God, with authority to influence people, and touch lives, and with abundance of material wealth. That's blessing. That's blessing. Another thing that I need to say about this is, this teaching, this whole idea of blessing came about in chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Genesis. When did sin come in? Chapter 3. Chapter 1, chapter 2 is perfection, you know, perfection. There was nothing wrong with the world. Every day when God created and ended his day, he would say, God saw and it was good. And the next day, God saw it was good. So there's nothing wrong with the world at the time. See, our idea of blessing sometimes has been, I have a need and God gave and that was a blessing. That's a blessing, but that really, you don't, your blessing is not just to meet a need, not just to fill a hole. Blessing is not just that. Blessing is something value added. So, if perfection, chapter 1 and 2, perfection can do with God's blessing, how much more we need God's blessing? How much more we need God's blessing? I think we should not be ashamed to acknowledge our need for God's blessing. Some people fear so much about the idea of falling into the heresy of prosperity gospel that they also feel embarrassed about asking God to bless them. But blessing is all over the Bible. Even when the world was perfect, God already blessed. But I have in my mind the picture of God just always, just with like itchy fingers, always want to bless. He doesn't need to bless. It's perfect already, but he just wants to bless. God wants to bless you. And I think we should have that desire to see God bless us, to see God bless our people. Not an embarrassment. God will give you abundance. God will give you authority. And God will approve of you. That's blessing. And then if you superimpose our idea of the value system that's created in the Old Testament about nationhood, God, people, and land, you'll find how they match up quite nicely. So just as a teaser for you to continue your study about blessing, go through the Bible and see what it does with the word blessing. But the basic understanding, blessing is divine abundance, blessing is divine authority, blessing is divine approval. That's blessing. First three times mentioned in the Bible before corruption came in through sin. Last module, I'm going to move through a little fast, but if you have any question, I can fill them after 5 o'clock. It's okay. And you can always email me, and after the end of the session, if you need to, I'll be very happy to copy a file for you, my slides. Module 4, missions, towards a holistic understanding. Just now, the question from Sister Shirley has to do with a more admit, I will try to answer the question, and she will probably find the answer somewhere in this whole teaching session, module number 4. This is Trinitarian Christianity, Father, Son, and Spirit. Usually, let me give you all the slides. Usually, creation, the part is associated with the Father. Three times God came down to earth. God actually came down three times. I call them the three missionary events. God actually came down. First time in creation, God dirty his hands and made man. Second time, God came down as Jesus and lived among men. Third time, God came down as the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. So the creation event, or sometimes we call it Easter or Christ event, and the third time is the Pentecost event. Sometimes I call them the missionary events. God made three missionary journeys to earth. he actually came down. Of course, we are speaking in what we call anthropomorphic terms. You know, God is always here, God is everywhere. But the Bible describes God as actually being involved on earth in these three times. Actually, it could be the Christ event better. I think the other slides I put Christ event, is it? Christ event would be better. Yeah, right. I would prefer Christ event rather than Easter. So the birth, the life, the death, and the ministry, death, and the resurrection of Christ. Thank you for noticing that. Different Christian tradition, they lead towards certain emphasis. So Catholics and liberals lead towards creation. Now, here I want to say that I am not using these labels in any negative way. Now, most of us, perhaps, are raised up to think of liberals as in a very negative way, but I'm not using these labels in a negative way. That's brothers and sisters who have a different tradition, a different background, different history. They lead towards creation side. The evangelicals lead towards the Christ event. The Pentecostal charismatics, of course, leads towards the Pentecost side, the Spirit event. So all these three events suggest three different Christian traditions. These are three intervention events. These are like three missionary acts of God. God came down three times: creation, the cross, and then also the last event, called the Pentecost event. We are quite understandably very proud of our tradition as Pentecostals and Charismatics. We tend to think of our history as maybe that God has used to take over. Oh, these others, they have become cold, they are no longer on fire, now we are on fire. Now we are revived, so we are. But I think that kind of language is not very helpful for the Christian church. I think God has brought us in His own mercy and grace to complete the work that He began, rather than to overthrow or supplant somebody else's work. We can look at history with a revival history with an addition motive or with a subtraction motive. A lot of times we look at it with a subtraction motive pattern or subtraction or what we call purgative punishment. Purgative motive. So we started, we said, the church started here, X perfect church, and then the church began to sin, become cold. And then during in 10, I think it's 53 or 35, Orthodox church split. The Holy Roman Empire split the two, and then the Orthodox, Eastern Orthodox split away. So now left behind the true church, the Roman Catholic, is the Orthodox. We don't hear very much about them. The only Orthodox denomination that I know of in Malaysia is the Mar Thoma Church. So they split from them, so they have lost the lead. So now we have the Roman Catholic Church. And in 1522 or so, there was the Protestant Reformation. And again, the Roman Catholic Church had become cold, so the Lord took them away. They can't go to heaven, now it's a Protestant. Then they also grew cold, and then you have a lot of other revival, you know, Pietistic revival and other things. And finally, we have the Pentecostals who came, you know, and so now we have the Pentecostals. And then now, some of them grow cold also, you know. So at the end, the only people left behind to go to heaven is the Assemblies of God. Of course, that's not true, but we have that kind of template or motif to describe history. whenever there's a revival, people who don't qualify are taken off. There is another way of looking at history, and this way of looking at history is the addition. It's like the motif of a river. Very interestingly, this is more of a fire motif. This is more of a river motif. And interestingly, over the last 15, 20 years or so, more and more churches are using this motif. They're calling themselves river or something, river and everything. So the fire motif is not as used so much already. It's kind of toned down quite a bit. The river motif is this. You know, at every revival, God adds something to the church. Something is added to the church rather than subtracted from the church in revival history. So I think that is a more helpful motif than to use the language of overthrowing, supplanting, usurping. Let me talk to you now as I build up my pattern. It's going to be a little bit complicated, but just flow with me. This is the integrating module, so this will help you. If you want to study the Bible, there are what we call parameters of meaning. A big word, but don't worry about that. It's easy, you know, when people say, "What do you believe?" "I believe the Bible." But there are so many interpretations of the Bible. So which one is correct? But I think the Bible, the meaning of the Bible is not just one thought. The meaning of the Bible is an area of meaning. The Bible is a revelation from God, and that is the objective meaning. You know, the revelation, we talk about revelation, we're talking about God revealing Himself. Let me see whether I can get this out. Okay, there are three, Revelation, relevance, and reader. In revelation, there's objectivity. In relevance, there's contextuality. In reader, there is subjectivity. You also provide the meaning in some way. Very dangerous to say, but when you read the Bible, your tradition, your bias, you as a reader will affect the meaning of the Bible, because you are an interpreter. And the context, how it's being applied, the relevance, will also affect the meaning of the Bible. Just very quickly, I'll look at all the three headings. The revelation, God reveals Himself to us in three ways. Creation, conscience, and Christ. Creation is God's works. The Bible says, the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. Conscience is God's witness. We know. God speaks to us. We know. Sometimes inside. We know. And then Christ is God's highest revelation. He's called the Word of God. He's called the Logos. Christ is the highest revelation. So these three very briefly describe to us the revelation of God, which is very objective. Objective, unchanging. Doesn't matter who you are, it's the same. The Word of God is the same. God's witness is the same. God's works are the same. The same God is being revealed to us. Very objective. In terms of relevance, there's more of a context. The different context will allow you perhaps to have a different interpretation sometimes. Quite frankly, all theology is contextual. All theology. Your context affects your theology. In fact, nowadays, they talk about Western theology, Asian theology, they talk about Black theology, feminist theology, midnight theology. Because when you read it with a context, your needs and everything will affect your focus, your emphasis. So that will affect the way you interpret, the way you will affect. Kraft says that theology, when perceived as irrelevant, is in fact irrelevant. This is, if you are preaching, if you're preaching, if what you preached is irrelevant, it doesn't matter if it is the truth or not. It doesn't matter if it is profound or what, it doesn't matter. If the people think it's irrelevant, it is irrelevant. Nobody will care. That's why it's so important when you preach that you build your introduction so well. People must be prepared to accept what you preach as relevant. Because if it is irrelevant, it will be irrelevant. People must see the need for it. This one, Kairos, everything, I will just skip it. The reader, there are different readings of the Bible. If you have a certain tradition, you focus on certain things and focus on certain things. So there's some kind of relativizing, it seems, but it's not really relativizing. You are internalizing it. Because when you read it, you internalize it, and it becomes of a special significance of meaning to you. Some people talk about Rhema versus Logos. So that the Logos becomes the Rhema. Actually, the two words have the same meaning and they are used interchangeably, but for Pentecostal and Charismatic circles, we have redefined the word so for our convenience. When we say Logos, we are talking about the unchanging word. When we say Rhema, we are talking about the word having special significance to us. It becomes a Rhema to us. So, very likely, it is one direction. Logos becoming Rhema. Am I right? You know, Acts chapter 2 verse 4 is a special significance to us. Acts chapter 2 verse 4 says, what does it say? In fact, last time when we buy a Bible, we check Acts chapter 2 verse 4 first. Those of us who are Pentecostals, Pentecostals, Charismatics. Acts 2, 4, you need to know that word. What does it say? Pastor Michael Jale may find it interesting. Acts 2, 4. Someone read it. Yeah. All of them spoke in other tongues. But there are some questions that say all of them speak in other languages. So don't buy that Bible. Pentecostal, Charismatic, I'm not allowed to buy the Bible. But you say, other tongues! Okay, you can buy the Bible. As Pentecostal, Charismatic, we read that verse differently. It has special meaning to us. We even judge whether a translation is good or bad based on just one verse. For other traditions, it's not so important. That became the Rhema for our movement. That Logos became the Rhema for our movement. But you know, you are thinking about it only Logos to Rhema. Is it possible for Rhema to become a Logos? What used to be a Rhema has become so common that he has become Logos again. Has X24 become Logos again for our Pentecostal movement? So, Rhema has, there needs to be a freshness in it to be a Rhema. If you lose that freshness, then it's as good as the Logos. There's a church here called Rhema Assembly of God, so this will be a Rhema to your church. So with your different tradition, it affects your reading of the Bible. But as you read it in a personal way, it becomes Rhema, you will internalize it. I want to say again, Rhema and Logos are two synonymous words. But for the convenience of Pentecostal Charismatic understanding, we have assigned them special significance so that we can at least differentiate how the Word of God works in our lives. Sometimes the Word of God works here, which we describe as Logos, and then when the Word of God begins to work here, we describe it as Rhema. just for our convenience. But
is it correct or not?
I think it's correct. I think it's correct because I'm not talking about whether the word is correct. I'm saying is we needed two words. We needed two words.
Is it the right way of approaching it?
Yes. I think so. Because you can read the Bible, which is the Word of God, without getting anything. It is the Word of God. It doesn't change. The fact that you didn't get anything doesn't make it less the Word of God. It is still Logos. But there are moments where it just jumps at you. For want of a better word, we just use the word rhema. It just jumped at you. When I was younger, I was trained how to do my quiet time. Read one chapter a day and then allow one verse to strike you. That was the word we used. And the verse that strikes you, we look for rhema in those days. Huh? Then you apply that verse. Find a way in the course of the day to apply that verse. One verse that strikes you. Does it mean that all the other verses are not the word of God? No. They're all the word of God. But that particular word, now described as rhema, is special significance to you. So that's the reader, the subjective element. When you put this intention with each other, you'll find that area of meaning for the Bible. That's how you interpret the Bible. You consider the revelation is the word of God. That is whether you agree with it, whether you don't agree with it, whether you like it, you don't like it, whether it has meaning to you or not, it is still the word of God. That's revelation. And this revelation is affected by relevance. When you apply it, when the apostles wrote it, there's special relevance, context to it. So when you read the Bible, you must know the context. When Paul wrote, he wrote to the Corinthians. He didn't write to you. So you must know the context of the Corinthians. And now when you apply it, you must filter it over 2,000 years of history and then apply it in today's world. That's the context. So it changes. But then there is also the reader. Because you are the reader, you're the interpreter, it impacts the meaning that comes to you. Just to further clarify the picture, the Pentecostals have been called people of the Spirit. But actually, someone wrote a book and said, actually Pentecostals are very holistic people. They are people of the head, the people of the heart, the people of the hands. They are people that are orthodox in their thinking. They are people that are very practical in their hands, their praxis. And they are people that are very emotional. They are people that are very empathetic. They are people of pathos, which is feeling. So Pentecostals love the Bible. Love the Bible. In the past, we carried big Bibles. We don't do that anymore. I remember one time I went out to the bookstore, went shopping with my friend, my classmate. Not my classmate, schoolmate, one of my senior. We went to Sufest to buy Bible. This guy found a Bible, he got a Bible, he went to the mirror and then he checked. Bible school is going to change. We are people of book. We love the Bible. We are very proud of our Bible. So we want our theology to be correct. That's why we have Bible school. That's why we have training. We want our theology to be correct. But we also are people that are very practical. We pray for the sick. We pray for people with problems. Very practical people. So our religion is not just some kind of theology. Our religion is a life we live now. But at the same time, we are also very emotional people, people of feeling. We cry, we shout, we raise our hands. So we are affected by our emotions. So we are actually very holistic people. The book is written by Stephen Lang. He's a Pentecostal scholar. The title of the book is Pentecostal Spirituality. Pentecostal spirituality is really a very holistic spirituality. So So in some way, it's seen in the way we interpret the Bible. We just don't reason it out here. It's important for us, but we also see whether it works. And we also have a certain immediacy. You know, one of the negative side of becoming an academician is, sometimes I cannot read the Bible without, you know, I cannot read the Bible. The Bible always comes to me through 2,000 years of history. There's no immediacy already. Once I know it's written to the Corinthians, I begin to, the Corinthians are like that, you know, and then it's changed, and Luther interpreted it. So there are 2,000 years of filters before it comes to me. That's quite unfortunate. It's all mediated through history and different contexts. But the person who is not a seminarian, the lady who is not really educated in my church, she reads the Bible as if God is speaking to her directly. Not through Corinthians, no. Directly, God speaks to her. And we call this the perspicuity of the Bible. It's a word, at least maybe when we end the session, you know that you can, you know that I was, I think it's spelled this way. Perspicuity. This may be wrong, I'm not sure. That belief is very, very precious to evangelicals. That means we believe that the Bible is so clear, anybody can understand it. You don't have to go to a seminary to understand the Bible. It's like perspex, you know, like a glass. Anybody can understand the Bible. So I lost that in some way. When I read it, I read it with the lens of an academician. And sometimes it's very hard to recover that immediacy of the Word of God. But Pentecostals are very immediate. Their feelings, their emotions. You know, of course, the negative side is sometimes the things don't go through the brain. The positive side is our feelings, our emotions are all involved, are all invested in our worship, in our service, in our ministry. That is Pentecostal spirituality, which is holistic Pentecostalism. Now, just now what I talk about is very technical. I know, very technical. That's why they're all in straight lines. But in real life, life is like a river. A river doesn't flow in straight line. Canals flow in straight line. Real life, rivers don't flow in straight line. Rivers meander, rivers, you know, they're not straight line. So your life cannot be determined by technical things you learn in the classroom alone. Real life is different from all the straight lines. Real life is not like a canal, it's like a river. And the bends and all the meanders, you don't know how your life will lead you to. So when you apply the Word of God, it's like applying in real life. Sometimes we call it living theology. So the river of living theology is unpredictable. It's easy to interpret the Bible in the classroom. But applying the Bible in real life is different. But evangelicals, and those of you who want to apply the Bible, we have a certain, boundary. You cannot have an excuse, life is different, and it's simply applied. No. There are two boundaries, a real river with two banks. And I would suggest that one boundary is this whole declaration. The Bible is the Word of God. You apply and you give authority to the Bible as the Word of God. I told you that Christianity is the only place where its adherents and members can critically evaluate. Not only the speaker in the church can critically evaluate its own scripture. Christians who actually say, oh, this is not the word of God. We are allowed to do that. A lot of other religions are not allowed to do that. If you say a scripture, the scripture that they have, if they say the scripture that they have is not the word of God, they will kill. If you say the scripture, their scripture is not the word of God, they will kill you. We are not allowed to intelligently scrutinize the word of God. But in a Christian church, you are allowed to. So, sometimes you begin to own the Bible rather than the Bible owns you. Because you evaluate the Word of God, you interpret the Word of God, you have control of the Word of God rather than the Word of God has control over you. So as you apply the Bible, the first principle I believe we all should remember is the Bible is the Word of God. The Bible has mastery over us, not we having the mastery over the Bible. That's important. Second bank is like a river with two banks. Is Jesus is Lord. Jesus is control of our lives. He is the Lord of our lives. That's why we obey the Word of God. That's why we obey Jesus. So these two, you have the human and divine. The Bible is the Word of God. The Bible, actually the word Bible is a very human thing. Bible means book, human book, written by humans, written by just common people. The Bible written by common people is the Word of God. Common literature is the Word of God. Human and divine. You can have Jesus, not Jesus, the Jesus of Nazareth, the human Jesus, and yet He is the Lord, the Jehovah God. So you have again the human and divine tension in this diagram that I'm trying to put up. I'm going to skip this, and perhaps you find this interesting. As we go along applying the Word of God, your Christian life will encounter different oppositions, different challenges, and interestingly, when you pioneer a church and you do missions, when you do pioneering missions, in the beginning phase of the missions, the devil's strategy is to put in fear. The devil is everywhere. You see the devil everywhere. You have the spirit of this spirit, that spirit, this spirit, that. The devil is everywhere. But especially in frontier missions, the devil is everywhere. But as the pioneering missions develops and mature, the devil's strategy is complacency. Now the devil is nowhere. And I think the Malaysian church is somewhere here. The problem is no longer fear. The problem now is complacency. The devil is nowhere. We no longer see the activity of the devil, because the devil very smartly, very cleverly has hidden himself. And as you become complacent in your blessings, as we become complacent in our Christian life, we just fall into that lull of complacency. And as we encounter these different situations, we will have different ways of going. Firstly, will be power encounter. That was everywhere, power encounter. When the church first started in Jinjiang, I tell you, there was a lot of power encounter. There's demonic spirits, things like that all happening. But as the church continues to mature, maybe truth encounter, love encounter would be the approaches to meeting the needs of the world and meeting the needs of the church. Now, the devil doesn't know everything, but he's quite smart. And he probably is listening to this also. And he's one of his agents. He doesn't want us now in Malaysia to think about him. him, you know, he's like, he, in fact, he's quite happy that we are enjoying our blessing. You know, he's quite happy that we are not doing very much. That's a strategy. And then you apply the Word of God, we apply it with power, encounter approach, with love encounter approach, with truth encounter approach. And, you know, these things all overlap. I'm not saying that these things, these are all technical lines drawn, that's why they're straight lines. Ultimately, all we want to do is to preach the gospel. That's ultimately. We want to preach the gospel. We want people to come to know Jesus. We want them to be saved. We want them to go to heaven. The Great Commission we want to fulfill. Actually, the Great Commission is quite interesting. All four Gospels end with the Great Commission. All four Gospels. You have it in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18-20, the most famous expression of the Great Commission. And then you have another one in Luke chapter 24. In the earlier passages, but the last two verses of Luke says that then they worship him and return to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stay continually at the temple praising God. Now this is quite strange. Jesus has just left them. Jesus just left them. How can they have great joy? They should be sad. They should be unhappy. They should be grieving. They shouldn't be having great joy. And yet the Bible says they left the place with great joy. I think the reason is because now they know they have a mission. They feel excited that Jesus had enough confidence in them to leave them with a mission. They're very eager to wait for the power of God to come. They don't know how it looks like, they don't know how it will be, but they're eager. They realize that Jesus will keep his word, and they now have a mission on earth. You see, if you take away the mission that Jesus gave to the church has no reason to exist. Sometimes we sing in the church songs of great joy, 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 and everything. Actually, we shouldn't be that happy. We're not in heaven yet. Well, we are happy because we have something to do. Because we have a mission on earth. Let me put all these things together, and this is how it will look like. This is my way of understanding Bible study, missions, and everything. Everything together. And this was what I used for years. For many years. Just to teach hermeneutics, teach missions, teach Christian life for many years. Then I found out there was something missing. Sister Shirley mentioned, raised up a question about, she mentioned about corporate social responsibility and everything. The question is really, is preaching the gospel the only reason why we're left on earth? If that is the only reason why we love on earth, then the 10 days that they spend between the giving of the Great Commission to the coming of the Holy Spirit is completely wasted. You know how many people died in the 10 days? If the 10 days, if that's all we do, then in fact, our time is wasted. Why are we doing it? We just go and just go to the street corner and preach and do everything we have. So we should spend our whole life preaching, 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 preaching. But we don't. We don't. We do so many other things with our life. We don't evangelize every second of our life. So there's something missing. Realize. So, the Great Commission may not be the only responsibility we have. It is an important responsibility because as Jesus comes again, these are the last days, perhaps it's the it's a priority, but it is not the only one. Today we need to have a fuller Trinitarian understanding. I come back to the Trinity. These things are held in tension a fuller Trinitarian understanding of the Christian mission, not just the Great Commission. Firstly, we have the cultural mandate. Let me read the verse to you. Genesis 1:28 says, God bless them and say to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth, subdue it, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. This is a command for us to take care of the earth. We are created as the, sometimes we refer to ourselves as the crowning glory of God's creation. God created us to take care of the earth, and He commanded us. The first command was to take care of the earth, rule over it, have dominion over it, subdue it. We call this the cultural mandate. The word cultural comes from the word agriculture. So missionologists call it the cultural mandate. We are supposed to take care of the earth. Then the second one is a great commandment. John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. The new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. But by this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. This is the commandment that Jesus gave. We call it the great commandment. Great commandment. Thank you. The great commandment. We don't really care too much, first of all, as Pentecostal charismatics, we don't care about the cultural mandate. We don't save whales, we don't save trees. we actually laugh at these people. And we think, if we even say that God created the world for us. Eat anything you want, barbecue anything you want, because God created it for us. Actually, it's not true. God did not create the universe for us. There are things created by God that no eyes will ever see. There are beauties under the sea that no human eyes will ever get to see. God created them. There are beautiful stars in the universe that we will never get to see in our lifetime. Because they are not created for us. It's nothing to do with us. It is created for His own pleasure. We are not really that important. We are important, God loves us. But God created all this for His own pleasure. So to simply declare, oh, God created everything for us, it's not true. It's not true. There are things that God created that has nothing to do with us. Nothing to do with us at all. Beautiful creation under the deep sea, we never get to see. Because God created them for His own pleasure. And God gave us a responsibility to look after the earth. Not to destroy it. Now, we are not too keen on these things, but I have Christian friends in Taiwan who will not eat in any restaurant that uses disposable chopsticks. He carries his own chopsticks around. He washes his own chopsticks. You know, he has those chopsticks and screw and make, you know, so very serious. They believe that they have responded. He told me that I don't want to leave my grandson with a world that he cannot live in. He's very serious about his Christian responsibility, and he is Pentecostal, the same to God. Very serious about his Christian responsibility to the environment. We have a cultural mandate. We also have a great commandment, a love mandate, to love other people like ourselves. Like God loves us. You know how Jesus loved people? Without condition. And sometimes we start orphanage, we start all these, old folks, we start all this. Because we have a motive. Ada udang di sebalik batu. Yeah, because we want them to come to our church. Because, oh no, of course we want them to come to church. Of course we want them to be saved. But if you know they will never come to your church, if you know they will never be saved, will you still do that? You know Jesus did that. He healed 10 lepers. Of course he knew, well, how many? Nine. Nine will be ungrateful. He knew. They will come back. Only one came back. How many did he heal? 10. Did he cause the nine to become leprous again? I don't think so. Because knowing Jesus, his love is unconditional. So, our Christian social involvement must have that same spirit of love. So I have separated this, this great commandment from the Great Commission. Because the Great Commission really wasn't a Jesus commission. Jesus told the disciples, don't do anything unless the Holy Spirit, until the Holy Spirit has come. Until the promise of the Father has come. So, theologically, this Great Commission doesn't come into effect until the Holy Spirit comes. So it is a Spirit's commission. So in some way with that, I can build up this neat structure with the Trinitarian mission. With the Father's mandate, the Spirit, the Son's love commandment, great commandment, and the Spirit's great commission. So you have a Trinitarian mission. The missiologists give a fancy word to it. They call it the, Missio de Trinitate. So, it is the Trinitarian mission of God. Sometimes we call it the Missio Dei, the mission of God. So the mission of God is not just the Great Commission. The mission of God has to do with the Father's cultural mandate, the Son's great commandment, and the Spirit's great commission. We have quite a few in our midst here who have approached their mission in life in slightly different ways. Reverend Michael Jale is from Malaysian Care, because Reverend Terence Sinodorai is in his Desama Jale. And loving people without condition. Loving people without condition. We're not doing this for church growth. We're not doing this, we want the church to grow. And we think this is good now. But we're not doing this because of that. We're doing this because we love people, just like Jesus loved them. I know it's quite a difficult issue to resolve because of our tradition background, but you know, when you start a Christian home like this, perhaps my brothers here approach it differently, but when you start a Christian home like this, where the Hindus will come and give food, the Buddhists will come and give food, the Muslims will come and give money, and you take them all. But when the Buddhists start a home, you don't give them anything. You don't support them. In fact, you pray that they will fail. So, it's evidence that suggests that we maybe are not loving people the way Jesus loved people. Unconditional. That's the love commandment. People that we cannot get anything from. People that may not even come to our church. So, these three, if you can triangulate it again, is where we get our mission in life. This is the Trinitarian mission for the church. It's the Missio Dei, Missio Dei Trinitate. So this is my conclusion. I didn't realize I have all these things. But this is where we put, I hang all my beliefs and all my teaching on these things. I have the Bible, apply it, and ultimately my goal is to fulfill the mission of God, the Trinitarian mission of God. Of course, let me see. In Paul's day, his involvement in the mission field caused him to write the Bible. Today, most evangelicals require us to read the Bible, apply it, and fulfill the Great Commission and the mission of God. That's why they say Pentecostals, Charismatics have the wrong direction. Because Pentecostal Charismatics, sometimes we experience it first, then only we go and read the Bible. You know, the people who spoke in tongues first at the beginning of the Pentecostal revival, they really didn't know anything. There was no theology for them to latch on to. It came to them, they experienced it, and then they went back to the Bible and find a theology for it. For a lot of mainline theologians and evangelical theologians, they feel that that's the wrong direction. You know, you're supposed to read the Bible first, get your theology right, then only you practice it. How can you practice and then after that you go and check? But Paul did that. Paul practiced and then Paul wrote the scripture. Of course, Paul's time is different. But I think it is really a bi-directional thing. I think it's a bi-directional thing. I think both. I think we read the Bible, we practice it, and we test it on the field, and we come back to the Bible, you know. Or we practice it, we go back to the Bible, we check it, and go back and practice it. So I pray that your life will be one that has a tension between the scripture and the ultimate objective of God. And as you fulfill the ultimate objective, or maybe you are not successful fulfilling the objective of God, you'll go back to the scripture. And then from scripture, you'll go back again. We live in that tension. Some people call it the spiral. The spiral. You just go back and forth, the spiral of hermeneutics. So this is really my idea of how a Christian life should be. I started by saying that the two most important mysteries of the Christian faith is the Trinity and the dual nature of Christ. These are all held in tension. I've tried to show you different ways how this Trinity, this triangulation, can be done in our understanding of God and His purposes for us, and then how this is brought to this whole diagram. Integrated with the vision of God and with the tension between the human and divine as we apply the Word of God. The Word, the Bible is the Word of God, human and divine. Jesus is Lord, human and divine. Okay? Any question? Because 5 minutes past my time. Any question? If you have any question and if you're embarrassed to ask or whatever, feel free to write to me. I'm on Facebook. Please message me. Don't put up the wall. Message me, and I'll be very happy to dialogue with you. And if you want to visit us, and APTS will welcome you to visit us. We have a little church there called the Bago International Chinese Church. You may want to come and visit our church too. If you have a short-term mission team, we'll be very happy to host you. Thank you for letting us network with you. Thank you for coming. And thank you for investing your time for this. Okay? I will be trying to have this in other towns in Malaysia. So if you know of anyone, you have one day, hopefully better if 2 days to spare, I would be very happy to go where I am invited. We can take care of the cost and everything, because I believe that it is time for me to give rather than to take. Okay? Well, if you have any... Yes? Yes. Just come over afterwards. Let me pray for you first. Heavenly Father, I thank you for my friends, my brothers and sisters who have taken time. I know, Lauren, this is precious holiday for them. Thank you, Lord, for bringing them here. I pray that you will bless them, watch over them, and this journey home, that you will protect them too. I pray that this, all that they've learned, Lord, will impact and apply in their own lives, in their church, in their community, and also impact other lives too, as they apply them in their own lives. We thank you for everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. I still have some books here. Well, if you will come, I will give you some. Take them. Two Chinese Bibles here. And surely I want to give these to you.